EP's twist with me.
Come on, twist.
Do the EP's twist with me.
Come on, twist.
Do that EP's twist with me.
Do the EP's twist with me.
Hi, it's Plastic EP here.
And I'm Wally.
From the EPs, and welcome to our new show that's called Collectible Hunt.
That's right.
How are you today, Wally?
Good, good. We've got a lot of stuff here today.
We've got a lot of stuff here. We're going to talk about now toys, tin lunch boxes, and a lot of items that are going to interest a lot of people out there. And I also want to say, with this stuff, it's getting rarer and rarer.
Now, even the reproductions are getting rare because people are just collecting anything now. So they're holding on to it. So something that gets reproduced becomes a collectible as well.
That's true. Now, I just want to mention a few things. For example, in the 60s, we had Corgi cars. These two are actually reproductions of those two cars. Now, they used to sell for somewhere up to $5 Australian at the time. Now, these actually retail from anywhere from $60 Australian. And I must say to you, if you're going to pay big money for collectibles from the 60s, be careful what you buy, because condition obviously has got a lot to do with it. And personally myself, unless you bought those items for next to nothing, you've got to ask yourself, what is the market out there? And the market will be what someone's prepared to pay for that. You'd agree, wouldn't you, Wally?
Yeah, condition relates to the price, and now it's getting harder to find mint condition items. So we're having to take on lower price or lower condition items for a collectible person. So you've got items that have come out originally, like this model here. The Green Hornet car.
That's a reissue, Wally.
Yes, at one stage the original, which I did have, and I got rid of it, that was very pricey because there was nothing around on a reissue label.
And the actual original, you can tell me if I'm right, he actually had his gun coming out of the door, and also that he had like a scanner at the back.
He had a scanner, he had a cannon in the front, and a movable figure of Kato. Now in this reproduction, they've given you the figure of Kato, which is even better than the original, because it's a larger item. But Green Hornet's become a fave now because of the new movie and that, but at one stage that was very collectible.
Well, we always remember the Batman episode where he actually catches up with the Green Hornet. That's one of my favourite episodes, and yours as well, isn't it?
It's called A Piece of the Action that's just been shown recently.
So that's the Green Hornet there. As I said, this is reissue. Yellow Submarine reissue. Monkey Mobile reissue. Now, speaking about the Monkey Mobile, this is one of my favourite toys, Wally. Now, this is the biggest Monkey Mobile I've ever found. Cost me about $100. It's a reissue. It's very rare now and very hard to get. And you've got to say, that's a nice item there.
Come out in a tin reproduction too. One of my friends had it, and it actually sold in one of the country fairs for quite a bit of money. And that was a tin item, which we're going to talk about tin items later on in the show.
Okay, getting back to what we're saying as well, Walt, I also want to show you these. Here's the Beetle, you want to grab that for a second?
That's very collectible, yeah.
From the Beetle cartoons, these are brand new dolls, which I'm very happy with these. And the other thing is, I've got to tell you about the Beetle cartoons from the 60s. I wish that whoever owns the rights to that, whether that's Apple, if they can remaster and put out the actual Beetle cartoons, I think a lot of people would like to see that.
Well, the Yellow Submarine's become flavourable yet again. New version of it, and these are the guys that actually animated the cartoon series. So the cartoon series figures, as you can see on this back of Paul, just gives you an idea of what they look like as part of the cartoons. Now the cartoons themselves, what did they run from? 65 to?
They ran from 65, and I think they ran for a few years. They were a King feature.
Yeah.
But I also want to say this, even though it was released in the US, it wasn't actually released in the UK till late in the 1990s, believe it or not.
That is amazing.
That's true.
Coming from their own homeland, you wouldn't think they'd get a reissue of it.
That's it.
Okay, here we are. Today we're looking at the tin boxes that came out in the 60s. Some are lunch boxes. Some are collectible metal boxes that contained either DVDs or items of that nature. In the 60s, the lunch boxes were very popular. I'm sure that every kid had a lunchbox of their own favourite character and that. These are reproduction lunchboxes, but modelled on some of the original 60s boxes. We've had the Irwin Allen shows, Thunderbirds.
These are my favourites. Land of the Giants, Lost in Space, and there's also a Monkeys collectible box, Warby.
Right, did you have the Monkeys collectible box?
No, I didn't. Most of that stuff was actually issued in America and not in Australia in the 60s.
So a lot of stuff didn't come out here, but now we have an opportunity for collectors, even ones who, just looking at the reproductions of it, they're fairly well constructed, low cost, and they would be a collectible item in the future, depending on the volume of sales. That's an original Roundtree chocolate box that I kept. I used to keep my toys in it, and most of the collectors are collecting either the shortbread boxes from the 30s or 40s, anything that takes their fancy. But most of the actual boxes that we have here, they were just new ways of remarking some of the old items. So you've got your favourite...
That's a beauty, that one.
The Beatles one, yeah.
That's a ripper, that one.
That's a nice one, the Beatles.
I like this movie one.
That was a nice package with a DVD, and you got a little robot inside.
Forgiven Planet.
Yeah, it was a really nice package. But all in tin boxes. They even market DVDs now in tins and try to cross-market the place. Corgi actually puts their own tins out with James Bond collectibles.
That's a beauty. I like that in the movie Real. I reckon that's unreal. This one here also, Astro Boy, the TV series.
Yeah, they got the cars coming into it, so they package them that way. But it's the tin that makes the actual collectible item. And I think the tin makes it look really impressive for a collector, something to show to their fans or their friends. And the way the tins are constructed now, they just put the DVDs in, so you get a DVD with your tin. So that's a nice item if you're a fan of a particular type of movie. Some of the cult movies are being packaged this way, and it's a nice thing to have. But lunch boxes for any character, they were very popular, and most of the characters, like you said, the Monkeys, I think Kiss, and a whole lot of big range.
There's a thermos that actually comes with the boxes as well. Right. So the other thing with the lunch boxes is if you took it to school, when you went to primary school, your lunch wouldn't actually get crushed. So you've got a very nice collection here, Wally, on tin boxes.
Yeah, the submarine one was with the thermos, and that's worth quite a lot of money now. It's in the thousands, I think. So you've got the original yellow submarine lunchbox with a thermos. That would be a collectible item as such.
Okay, well, that covers our tin lunchboxes.
Yeah.
Anyway, Wally, I just want to tell you, we're going to play an E-piece clip now, and let's have a look at this.
Bunny girl, she's my Easter bunny girl. She brings me chocolates and lots of kisses. She's so much fun, I'm always missing her. She's my Easter bunny girl. She's my Easter bunny girl. When we're walking hand in hand, understand the love she feels. She's my Easter bunny girl. She's my Easter bunny girl. Ooh, ah, ooh, yeah. I love her, she loves me. Bunny girl, she's my Easter bunny girl. She brings me lots of chocolates. Yeah, she's so much fun. She's my Easter bunny girl.
Okay, Wally, now you're going to talk about Yardbird singles, and EPs. And this is your private collection here, so we'll let you discuss it.
Yeah, that's right. Well, over years, I've amounted some collectibles of EP singles. EPs were virtually a single with really about five or six songs on them. And they were good value for people who loved the bands and that. And you got more for your money. Now, they usually have a picture cover, and a lot of artists, or most artists of the 60s, had their songs put out as EPs. And the EP standing for extended play. They were virtually a package of having most of the hits on them and giving you a small version of an album so they could play. Now, Yardbirds had quite a lot over the world. You've had picture singles, picture EPs of the band, some reproducing the albums they came out on, but in a small version. They were more affordable than the album and easy to play because they were a single size, 7-inch to be fact. A lot of people still prize them because of the picture quality.
Yeah, they love the covers.
Yeah, love the covers. The singles, you got the single, but you didn't get the actual album. So if you'd got the single, you'd only get this. I mean, that's fine to look
just
at.
Just a paperback cover.
Visually, albums and EPs, were that's the best way you can collect the artists. Yeah, so
you can also frame that wall. Yeah, a lot of people frame it on the walls. They love it that much.
That's right. And I think the old albums are actually becoming an art form, and people are looking to frame that sort of stuff because of the quality. Very hard to do that with CDs. Very small. Very hard to read. You need reading glasses like me to read this sort of stuff. But they're still available, and you can still find a lot of the artists. Some of them go for quite a bit of money. I know the Led Zeppelin ones went through quite a bit. All the Monkees had their EPs and singles put out in picture covers.
Well, speaking about the Monkey EPs, I've actually got mine here, and I'm going to show you my collection. But if you notice how you go to secondhand record stores, and most of these EPs, they've got them up on the wall charging you about $60 to $80 because that's how dear they are.
Yeah, they've gone up in price, that's true, because they'll never be reproduced again. This is the thing. I mean, they are reproducing albums, and vinyl's become another taste, but for some reason not doing these, maybe because they're very hard to press, or I'm not sure, but I know the 10-inch ones came out as well, but vinyl has a new resurgence in people's collections now.
I agree. Anyway, you got a very nice collection there, yeah. Wally, and I also got a surprise for you. Guess who turned up?
Who turned up?
I found George.
George has turned up too.
So I found George. Grab it.
Yeah.
I found George now to grab with everybody. Let's show the four of them. Just grab that one too. Let's show the four while we've got it. I mean, we might as well see the four. Oh, that's fantastic.
Well, there's only two left, in reality.
Let's not go there. Okay, Wally, now we're going to talk about Monkees EPs and singles from the 60s, and I've actually got all the original ones, which are really good. I just want to say, with those, in Australia, we had Volume 1 and Volume 2. Volume 1 was actually the blue one. That's the first Monkees EP that ever came out, and it was followed by Volume 2. Some great songs on that, Wally.
Now, these EPs and singles, they look like they had four or five songs. As I was saying before, that was a great way to push the artist. And also having Volume 1 and Volume 2 made it even more collectible because you needed to get either one.
Okay, here's Mary Mary, how it came out in Australia. It was released with RCA. It came out just in a paper fold. I've got Oh My My. That's when the Monkees split, and there was only two of them left, Mickey Dolenz and Davy Jones. I've also got a Japanese EP here, which you'll find very interesting, Wally. This one actually became a calendar. Look at this. This is very interesting.
Look at that. Yeah.
That's a calendar.
Oh, that's very nice.
And that's got 1968 on it.
The Japanese did a lot of good reproductions of
And there's the record.
They actually reproduced lyric sheets in the albums when they reproduced the vinyl. They were doing a very good job.
Now, I've actually bought a lot of overseas EPs and singles from other countries. For example, I'm a Believer, and you can see there's a shot from the pilot episode of the show as the cover. Same thing there again. They're both from overseas. Now, with Davy Jones, I've got some very rare EPs. One of them was this one. This is actually when the Monkees were at their height in about 67. He actually put this out on Astor Records. As Davy Jones, is not as the Monkees. So that's rare. One of the rarest EPs that you will find, and it's the hardest to actually track down, is Davy Jones. That one there, that's very, very hard to find. RCA released this one.
Well, that one it doesn't represent the artist, because the artist, David Jones, at the time of recording, he had very short hair. He hadn't actually created his image yet. Dreamgirls on it, very good song, still gets played on the radio. And yeah, that was just a cash-in job by the Monkees themselves.
Here's another one by RCA, just titled David Jones, and it's got the four Monkee songs on it. He's walking on the beach. And also I've got a TV Week official member of the TV Week Monkee Club, believe it or not. That's pretty rare.
It's got the heads on the...
It's got the heads and the names on it there.
Yeah, very nice. It's a beauty, that one.
So that's basically David Jones' EPs and singles that were released here in Australia. With the other EPs, you'll find there's so many with that. And I've got the hot collection. One more thing I will mention, which is very, very rare. I've actually got the Magical Mystery Tour.
That's the UK version.
This is the UK version. That's two singles on either side with the book. That's very hard to find in mint condition. Now, Ollie, behind you, I just want to say this is one of my best collectibles. I've actually got that. That's 500 of them in the world that were made, and they were signed by the Monkees. So that's one of my favourite posters. Just thought I'd make mention of
that. What number of the 500 is that one?
It's got it there, 88.
88, that's
88 of 500. As I said, the lower limited release and the lower number, the more it's worth. So that basically sums up all my Monkees EPs. Now, I've got something special for you here. This is our first plastic EP in the records. When we first started in 79, we were known as Plastic EP in the Records.
That's right.
Not many people have seen this because there's only 250 made in the world.
Yeah.
And that was it. At Home, that was our first single. Flip Side, Three Special Words. Very hard to find now. It virtually doesn't exist. I've also got our second single, which is by the EPs. We changed our name from Plastic EP in the Records to the EPs, and the release on that was Forget All I Said and Secret Love.
Let's have a look. Now, the first thing I noticed with all our singles and EPs that we've shown today on the show, they still have the paper covers. This kept the single in pristine condition. The first thing people did when they bought these in the 60s was throw that away, and they put these things in a metal holder.
Yeah,
now, the metal holder has actually had a resurgence now. They, people think it's part of some sort of trendy thing, but really it does damage to the single.
Yeah, the KTEL Selectomatic. Do you remember that with the albums?
Oh, well, the album, that was not too bad because it didn't wreck it, but this, by taking it out of here and putting it in a metal groove, it actually caused damage. My sister destroyed all the covers. She even got rid of the picture covers, and she just kept the singles in a unique sort of metal holder. I mean, say, if you went to a party, you used to have one of these. This is a
yeah, that's right.
Form, and that protected all your
singles. You took that with you, yeah.
You took that with you, easy portability, and then you could find them when you after you recovered from the party.
Well, Wally, that wraps up our collectible hunt tonight. We've got one more clip to show you, Cry Like You Do by the EPs, and I want to say it's been a pleasure today, Wally.
Yeah, it's very nice. I think the show, it gives you something to look forward to, and I hope all you collectors out there keep collecting, and it doesn't matter what you collect, as long as you're happy and you're enjoying it, that's the main thing.
See you from Collectible Hunt.
Bye.
Yeah. Cry like you do when you want it to. Cry like you do like you want it to. Cry like you do when you want it to. Cry like you do when you want it to.
Cry like you do when you want it to. You make me blue, yeah.
Cry like you do when you want it to. Cry like you do when you want it to. Cry like you do.
Time you can love me.
'cause you're the most. I just need your love always. Can't you see that I'm for you?
You can love me all the time. You can love me all the time.
Yeah.
You can love me all the time. You can love me all the time.
Time. I just need you all the time. You can love me all the time. You can love me when you're all you do is reach out to me. You can love me when you're all you gotta do is reach out.
Time.